My dear students of class 8A and 8B, today the following lesson number 8 I am going to teach as per the following points mentioned in the board. Consequences of the wars, first to third Anglo-Maratha war. Consequences of the Anglo-Maratha war, role of British East India Company. And another point later on I shall add in the board and explain. You know what was about the consequence of the Anglo-Maratha war? There are several consequences of the Anglo-Maratha war. You know the first Anglo-Maratha war continued for how many years? The first Anglo-Maratha war continued for 7 years. The first Anglo-Maratha war continued for 7 years. But both the two sides, the Marathas and the British, could not achieve much success. And ultimately, it was ended. This first Anglo-Maratha war was ended with a treaty named the Treaty of Salwa in the year 1782. And afterwards, the war was ended. The war ended without decisive victory from both sides. And but in fact, the East India Company was able to establish their superiority by fighting against the Marathas. The Marathas also came to know about the strategy of the British, about the leadership of the British, about the technique and method of the British, and about the strength of British forces. That's why they all were scared of the British. And apart from this, in the first Anglo-Maratha war, both the two sides from the very beginning were determined to achieve success, were determined to defeat each other. But unfortunately, there was no concrete result of the first Anglo-Maratha war. Why? Because both the two sides fought bravely. Both the two sides tried to learn how much powerful both of the two sides, that means the Britishers, were trying to estimate it, how much powerful the Maratha forces were. On the contrary, the Marathas also were trying to learn how much powerful the British forces were. But while fighting against each other, both the two sides came to know that both the two sides were powerful, but in comparison to the strength of the Maratha forces, the Britishers were more powerful. The Marathas realized it also, and the Britishers, by way of fighting against the Marathas in the first Anglo-Maratha war, they proved their political and military superiority, and also gave a message to the Marathas that the Britishers had come to India not to trade but to rule the whole country. And in the second Anglo-Maratha war, which was broken out. After a few years later, the Maratha kingdom during the second Maratha war was defeated by the British. In the second Anglo-Maratha war, the Marathas were defeated by the British. In the beginning, I told you that the Britishers communicated a message for the Marathas that the first Anglo-Maratha war was nothing but a trial game. But but a preliminary trial game for the British, and in the second Anglo-Maratha war, the Marathas would be defeated. That Maratha would be defeated by the British was sure. That's why the Marathas also felt it that due to British expansionist policy, due to the growing political and military power of the British, and due to the technique and strategy, due to introduction of newly made sophisticated weapons which were used against the Marathas, they would be unable to do something against the British. Because after the Industrial Revolution, so many new sophisticated weapons were made from the factories and industries, but these were unknown to the Marathas. They did not have any knowledge of it. And when the first Anglo-Maratha war started, the Britishers realized it, and realized also that during the second Anglo-Maratha war, they would be unable to defeat the British. And what they felt came to be true. During second Anglo-Maratha war, the British defeated the Marathas, and the rulers of the Maratha nation, the Bhosle and Sindhia families, as well as Peshwa Bajirao too, were compelled to sign the terms of the subsidiary alliance which was introduced by Lord Wellesley, my dear students. So they were forced to give. Not only they signed the terms of the subsidiary alliance, but they were forced to give some of their lands and host British troops and the resident at their cost in their court under the terms of the subsidiary alliance. So the Bajirao too, the famous and powerful Bajirao too, the famous leader of the Maratha nation, he was also compelled to sign the terms of the subsidiary alliance, and also agreed to maintain a British force, a group of British force, group of British forces, and a resident in their court at their cost. Now, the third Anglo-Maratha war. The third Anglo-Maratha war was a great challenge for the Marathas, since during the second Anglo-Maratha war, they were defeated by the British, and they had to lose their independent rights. They almost all became dependent on the British, because under the terms of the subsidiary alliance, Bajirao too was forced to sign the subsidiary alliance, and also was forced to maintain British forces and maintain an office of British resident at their cost in their courts. That's why it was not only the insult of Bajirao too, it was the insult of the two families, Bhosle and Sindhia of Maratha nation, who both the two families were proud of their prestige, were proud of their bravery and skills and military skills. But this time, during second Anglo-Maratha war, the Marathas' dreams, the Marathas had to lose their dreams. The Marathas, the Sindhia, the Bhosle families were totally ruined, and Peshwa Bajirao too also had to consider defeat morally, politically and militarily, and was forced to sign the terms of the subsidiary alliance. That's why that group of Maratha leaders, from the very, very before starting the third Anglo-Maratha war, from the very, very beginning, they got themselves fully alert in order to defeat the British in the third Anglo-Maratha war. So the third Anglo-Maratha war was a prestige fight for the Maratha nation, and the British knew it. That's why they were fully prepared for it. And what was the result of it? The third Anglo-Maratha War was the final attempt made by the chiefs to regain. The British knew it, that the whole Maratha nation would try to regain their former prestige and glory by way of fighting against them. But before they got themselves united against the British, after the second Anglo-Maratha War, disintegrated the Marathas. As a result of it, the Maratha power was divided, the Maratha nation, the Maratha state was divided into many, many groups. Many, many chiefs also started ruling under their prime ministers, under their Peshwas, and there was no hope for the Marathas to be united and to gain victory against the British. As a result of it, the chiefs, they all decided to get themselves united in order to make the last attempt against the British. And ultimately what happened? Who took the leadership? Only the eminent ruler of the Maratha nation, the Bajirao II. This was done under the leadership of Peshwa Bajirao II. But once again, he was defeated in the third Anglo-Maratha War, my dear students. Once again, Peshwa Bajirao II was defeated in the third Anglo-Maratha War and was dethroned and pensioned off to Bithur, a place near outside the state Maratha in Kanpur. Not outside, within Maratha kingdom, but in Kanpur, a place Bithur. He was dethroned and pensioned up to Bithur, a place of Kanpur. And most of the Maratha territories were annexed under the expansionist policy of the British Empire, under the terms of the subsidiary alliance. Thus, with the defeat of the Marathas, the powerful Marathas, the independent and powerful Maratha kingdom was totally disintegrated, and the British became the chief political power, the chief military power in Indian subcontinent. By this way, the third Anglo-Maratha War was also ended with the defeat of the Marathas and with the victory of the British East India Company. So, by this way, the three most important battles were fought between the Marathas and the British East India Company. In the first Anglo-Maratha War, the British and both the two sides, the British and the Marathas, realize how much powerful they were against each other. But the Britishers could not achieve much success. On the contrary, the Marathas also. But the Britishers, comparatively in comparison to the Marathas, had gained much priorities and showed and proved that they were more powerful, they were more strong than the Marathas in the first Anglo-Maratha War. But when the Marathas were going to be defeated, and the Britishers realized it was not important to them to sign one peace treaty with the Marathas, because that they would defeat the Marathas was sure, and they had been eagerly waiting to see the defeat of the Marathas. Meanwhile, the Maratha leaders proposed to sign a peace treaty, and the Britishers also were confused whether they should sign peace treaty with the Marathas. But the Britishers waited in order to defeat the Marathas comfortably in the second Anglo-Maratha War. That's why temporarily the British signed a treaty with the Marathas in the year 1782. So the first Anglo-Maratha War was ended with the Treaty of Salba in the year 1782. And what the British What strategy the British adopted? They proved it in the Second Anglo-Maratha War. And in the Second Anglo-Maratha War, the British defeated the Marathas. The Marathas were badly defeated by the British in the Second Anglo-Maratha War. And as a result of it, they all were disintegrated. The Maratha power was disintegrated, and the entire parts of Maratha state, Maratha nation was divided into various groups under their chiefs and the prime ministers. They started ruling their respective, areas from their respective areas as chief or as military, as chief or as prime minister. The British wanted to do it because they knew that the Marathas would try to get themselves united while fighting against the British in the Third Anglo-Maratha War, which was likely to be held. And afterwards, the British, by thinking it, the British disintegrated the Maratha nation, divided. There were so many group of Marathas, and the British started plotting against them. And hence, by way of interfering the internal political crisis of the Marathas, and as a result of it, so many groups also were formed within the Maratha territory, within the Maratha kingdoms. And everyone started ruling separately. So there was no unity among the Marathas. It resulted in a great victory in the Third Anglo-Maratha War by the British. That's why the strategy of the British. What was about the strategy of the British? The British adopted a good strategy. To defeat the Marathas. So it was a technique and strategy of the British strategy to defeat the Marathas. What strategy they had adopted? The British, before the Third Anglo-Maratha War, adopted the strategy to disintegrate the Marathas and to divide the Marathas into small groups where, under their chiefs or under their prime minister, they would rule by themselves, and there would be no Maratha king, there would be no complete leader of the Marathas, and there would be no complete Maratha kingdoms. Everyone would rule by means of their own administration, own introduction of administration, but there would be no unity among the Marathas. Before the Third Anglo-Maratha War, the British adopted that technique and method and strategy. And what technique and method and strategy they adopted? It helped them to defeat the Marathas in the Third Anglo-Maratha War. So, the Marathas, under the leadership of Bajirao II, what attempt they made against the British, it was of no use. The Marathas were defeated badly in the Third Anglo-Maratha War and was forced to sign the terms of the subsidiary alliance. So, most of the important territories, the entire kingdoms under the Marathas came under the British control, and the British proved that they were the real masters in Indian politics and had come to India and came to India. They have come to India to rule that country, not only to trade with that country, but to rule that country, to rule this country. And ultimately, the British East India Company, disintegrated due to the effort of the British East India Company. The Maratha Kingdom was disintegrated. Up to this, my dear students. Thank you.